Hello, everybody, and welcome to this Sherpa project interview. My name is Marianne Lazarovici, and I work at the European Business Summit. And as part of the Sherpa project, I work on disseminating our recommendations and our advocacy work. I'm very pleased to be that we are joined here today with Iván García del Blanco. You are a Spanish member of the European Parliament, a member of the SND group. You are Vice President of the Legal Affairs Committee, and you are also the rapporteur on the framework of ethical aspects of artificial intelligence, robotics and related technologies. So in this light, I'm sure we will have a very interesting conversation on AI and ethics. And Bernd, I can give the floor to you to introduce our viewers to Sherpa.
Thank you very much, Marianne. So my name is Bernd Stahl. I'm the coordinator of the Sherpa project. Sherpa is an EU-funded project that looks at the ethics and human rights aspects of AI and big data. We've done a number of activities to identify what those possible issues are. We've come up with a set of recommendations, and we're now delighted to talk to one of the experts in the European Parliament around this to get a view for where we stand at the moment and what the current thinking around ethics, human rights, AI, and big data are. So, Iván, thank you very much for joining us. And my first question to you would be, with regards to the regulatory framework, what do you think it should cover? So what should be the principles behind the regulatory framework that the EU should issue with regards to new technologies?
Thank you very much for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. And I think you are doing a high profile work and so profitable for us, for legislators. Just going directly to your question, I think we have to make sure that with our regulation, look after our fundamental rights are covered in a broad sense, besides our own principles, which are strengthened in our charter, in our Treaty of Lisbon. And it includes, for example, gender equality, environmental sustainability, things that for us as European Union are main important as well as the rest of the fundamental rights. So we try at last to make sure that the investigation, the investment, the different parts, even the different parts from every corner of the world that are used in European Union, complies with our principle and ethical standards.
Okay. And what do you think are the limitations of a regulatory approach? Where can it not go?
I think it's a phenomenon so hard to be regulated because it's a lively material that is improving every day, that it's even difficult to foresee in a bunch of months time. So you have serious problems, serious difficulties in order to make sure that everything is encompassed, every of the aspects, every of the possibilities that this technology entails is encompassed in our regulation. And at the same time, we have to strike a balance between a regulatory frame that covers and protects human beings and consumers and citizens, and on contrary, don't stifle the investment, the research, the development of this technology. We have to find exactly what is the point of balance, and it's, as you can guess, is so difficult when we are trying with an absolutely new material.
Okay. So, I mean, we don't know is the exact shape that the regulation will take. But one of the questions that I find really interesting is the one around enforcement. So what do you think will be enforcement mechanisms in order to ensure that these values that you've mentioned earlier are actually protected?
In our report, in our legislatory proposal, we tried to design a mechanism that begins from the top, from the European Union, and from the action of European powers, but trying to build a net under this top that spreads throughout the member states. We have the example, not to go beyond this point, we have the example of the GDPR, the problems that the GDPR were for its enforcement, and we tried to learn from this from this lesson, trying to be so pragmatic as we could when we designed this. I hope that the Commission in the new drafting that is going to be in a question of weeks or months takes into account this reality that needs, I think, to be as well quite flexible, a quite flexible frame. I think we have not to be so steady, so hard. No, I think we need so flexible frame that could adapt itself to the new releases, to the new technologies that we could came across our path. Because the reason that I mentioned before, we are in front of a lively material.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So one aspect of this regulatory framework that you've proposed and that also the Sherpa project has adopted as a proposal, as a good idea that we think should be put in practice, is this idea of a European agency for AI. Can you say a little bit about what that would look like, what you think it should do and how it should be constituted?
I think it's it doesn't matter the exactly shape or better said, the exactly nature, because here we had a short quarrel about the nature of whichever agency or whichever body, European body. I think it's not as important as to have a body that has enough competences and enough power to even make decisions day by day, to avoid to have to be making regulation every step or in front of every of the aspects that could surprise us in our path. So I think we need this mighty, from a European perspective, this mighty agency or this mighty European body with enough competences and to harmonize as well the development at national level of the European framework. We have to take into account as well that we need some kind of European body that could is mainly for individual researchers or for entrepreneurs or for small and medium entrepreneurships. The regulatory frame is easy to deal with because it's another of the risks that hard regulation could entail with no? The problem for the small fishes to adapt to the complements of this kind of regulation. And we thought that this kind of European agency could, for the small and medium enterprises, to make easily adapt to this new regulatory framework.
Okay. So you talked about the impact that regulatory frameworks have on businesses, individuals, and so on. What do you think is the process, or is there a process, whereby small and medium enterprises, but also civil society organizations, research organizations, could feed into the development of the framework and the shaping of the framework? Do you have any ideas how that might work?
I think must be absolutely necessary to have this exchange, constantly exchange of views and dialogue between institutions and civil society in every of the aspects you mentioned. And besides, one of the things, one of the duties that we thought for this European agency is to make sure that this dialogue is constant and accomplished by institutions at European level, but at national level as well. Because we are in front of a technology that is able to change everything, to change our way of life, to change the shape of our democracies. We need to make sure that the common people is aware about what this technology could implies, could entails, and to be able even to make decisions in this regard. We are at the end at a democratical debate, and I think it's absolutely necessary that we make sure that institutions have this kind of dialogue with civil society.
Okay. So my last prepared question is around the aspect of green IT and the impact or the relationship between environmental concerns, global warming, So how do you think these two areas of concern come together? How do they interact? And what do you think policy can do in order to ensure that AI and sustainability work hand in hand?
In our report, we put a mandatory principle about environmental sustainability. And we tried as well, not only in this sense, but when we are talking about public interest, we try to make sure that these areas that are not from economical immediately profit are in the same way investigated and are in the same way secured to be developed even by the public institutions. It's for our perspective a mandatory. We know that if we don't make anything, the carbon footprint from the systems that this kind of technology needs to run could broaden, could fatten the problem with global warming. But at the same way, and at the same time, we know that this kind of technologies in its nature have the possibility to ease up a better balanced development. But we have to make sure that take it into account when this kind of technologies are designed. So it's for our perspective, from the perspective of the European Parliament, not only my group, it's absolutely necessary that these things are taken into account. And I'm absolutely sure that for the Commission will be the same.
Thank you very much. I think that was very insightful. And it's, of course, a very exciting time right now because we are awaiting the regulation, the draft, and we'll see how it goes in the next few months. So as the closing statement, from your perspective as a policymaker, as someone who's at the heart of it, so what do you think is the key message that you would like to disseminate to the world at large, to citizens, but also to researchers? What do you think is the most important thing that needs to be done right now?
I think the most important is that European institutions are absolutely aware that we need to strike the balance between research and between the protection of human being and human dignity. So we are trying to step forward in this regard, and we are trying at the same time as we made in the past, that once the European Union moves in this way, the rest of the world can follow us, as it was in the past, the so-called Brussels effect. No, it's our own superpower. We don't have a shared army or things like why is the other superpowers, but we have the more important, from my perspective, the more important superpower, that is the superpower of regulation and civilization. And in this regard, I think we have not to be so shy with this. We have to dare to act and to be the first, the forefront of this kind of regulation. So I'm sure that we are making our duties, and we'll try to balance our vision with the vision of the commissions and the vision of the council, with a marble stone or a cornerstone, that is the development of artificial technology must be absolutely going through the human dignity.
Thank you very much for that. That was a very nice closing statement.